questions, if anyone's interested in asking any questions. You should never accept anything that anyone tells you that can't be changed, or never accept anything as being necessarily true. I think as long as you are always questioning everybody around you and not getting fired, it's a really good thing to do. I also think that through my experience in these different projects, there have been leaders in businesses, there have been leaders in industry associations, surprisingly. There have been leaders in municipal governments, there have been bureaucrats, there have been people in political offices. So I don't think I wouldn't think you have to be in any particular place to make change. I think you can make change wherever you end up, and I think it's important to have as many people in as many different places trying to make change. So as long as you're challenging the status quo, you're doing what you think is right, you're bringing your experience and expertise and enthusiasm as a young person starting out, I would just focus on, you know, trying to do what you think is the right thing. And I know when I started out, it was always thinking, for me, you know, am I having fun? Am I learning something? And, you know, secondarily, am I making enough money to live? And if you can match all those three, it's kind of like the ecology, economy, society things for yourself. You just do a right balance, but, you know, don't put economy first. Make sure that you're thinking about, you know, your own sort of social and ecological values going forward. That was specifically greenhouse gas emissions of those provinces, and really what you have to do in the same way you would here is look at, you know, what is the resource sort of profile of each of those provinces. So we do have oil and gas in the east and a little bit in the west, but predominantly it's in Alberta, and so all of the, you know, the tar sands development is in Alberta. But I think because of that, and it relates to the earlier part around the status quo, Alberta has, you know, literally, no pun intended, really dug in on their whole oil extraction industry. And so whereas in Ontario, we don't really have a lot of fossil fuels in the ground, so we don't have a government that's really nervous about regulating fossil fuels. So part of the argument that I was making in our campaign was, we're importing coal from Alberta, we're importing coal from Ohio. We don't really care about, you know, what's going on in Alberta and Ohio economically. We want to make sure we care about the health of Ontarians. So a big part of it just happens to be who's got a whole lot of oil in the ground, and Alberta's got a whole lot of oil in the ground. But that the fact that they do affects, you know, then, you know, their interest in protecting it. There is a big movement. In fact, there are organizations, I would say more of them, environmental groups in the U.S. that are concerned that with all of the pipeline fights and all the movements against pipelines, the oil companies have shifted a lot of the oil exports to the U.S. from Canada on rail, and so there are people that are tracking that and running campaigns on that. And I think, for me too, that's one of those unintended consequences of a successful campaign against pipelines, because whether you like pipelines or not, they are, you know, safer than shipping oil through trains, but we've now increased, you know, probably 10 or 100 fold how much oil is traveling on trains. A couple of the organizations that I referenced, and maybe the one that's right now looks most promising, is Canada's Ecofiscal Commission. And so its mandate is basically to figure out how do we shift the fiscal policies, so financial and tax policies of the country, but it could be federally, could be provincially, could be municipally. Right now we're focusing provincially. That seems to be where the most action is. And so it's and the commission has on it 12 economists that are considered to be like mainstream economists. These aren't, you know, kind of ecological, you know, wacko economists, and some of them very conservative. And so what they're doing is looking at how do we, so recognizing that it we can make the economy more efficient if we reduce waste, reduce inefficiency, reduce pollution, and start putting prices on things. So congestion pricing on roads, for example, pricing waste disposal, and carbon pricing, which is the big one. And so in the last, again, I left this out on the positive side, Ontario just a couple weeks ago committed to carbon pricing through a cap and trade program between Quebec and California. So Ontario's joined WCI, and in fact, the Ontario Environment Minister is in Los Angeles today, coincidentally. So really it's just, so that's what, like one piece of it really is around pricing. So when I mentioned those three things, pricing, investing, measuring, those are the specifics. I didn't really drill down in any detail. Investing is looking at how do you shift capital markets so that investments are going from, you know, infrastructure in fossil fuels to infrastructure in clean technology. And so we've got a whole component looking very specifically at that. And then the third one, which is measuring, is if you're only measuring economic or you're only measuring basically progress through economic measures as opposed to social and ecological measures, you know, the old saying is, you know, what gets measured gets managed. So we're only really measuring the, you know, like every country in the world, right? GDP is really all that matters. And but we know that GDP is just a simplistic measure of economic output. So how do we look at measures that are more inclusive, and then over time having, you know, countries actually say, well, we're gonna, our measure isn't just about narrow GDP. And a simple first step on that is natural capital. So we've got a project right now looking at how do we get governments to start putting natural capital onto their accounting, which means, you know, right, I'm just without getting into too much detail, but right now there's only economic value in a forest once it's cut down, right? So you chop it down, it goes on the GDP, we've got economic activity. With the forest is standing, it has no value. If you look at basic, you know, assets and liabilities, you know, you want to look at your asset, which is the standing forest, not just, you know, your liabilities or, you know, or profit and loss. So so it's really important that we start measuring things that are of value in and of themselves, not just when they're cut down. And that's a big problem. I'm right now particularly excited about the notion of documentaries. I think because of the success of some of the big ones like Food Inc. and the Corporation and some of the early Michael Moore stuff, I think there's a growing recognition that documentaries actually are quite influential. And I think just the way people are receiving media, documentaries seem to be working well. Also, maybe coincidentally, there's one of the biggest documentary film festivals in the world is on in Toronto right now called Hot Docs. And there's all sorts of excitement around that. So I think it's a growing, it's really being understood as a growing and important way of influencing people. For me, it was saying, okay, well, let's just stop talking about the problem being, you know, acid rain, smog, all these things, and, you know, this environmental groups had all their little campaigns about all these things. Let's just go after the source of all of this stuff and focus on coal plants. So that was sort of number one. And then number two is, if we're going to focus on coal plants, what is the single biggest motivating factor in our view, or, you know, my view early on? It was looking at the evidence of childhood asthma and hospital admissions. And so that, I think that really is what broke that frame and sort of reduced or eliminated that cognitive dissonance. So someone might still think, oh, here's some nutcase saying we should put in solar panels instead of shutting down coal plants. But if you're saying, if you don't even talk about that at all, and you say, you know, kids are going to the hospital because of coal plants, then suddenly it's like, ah, kids, hospitals, health, family, like that really was the breaking of that cognitive dissonance piece. So I think that's why we were successful. Like some of the, like, you know, the David Suzuki's of the world were saying coal and smog and all this stuff was bad for a long, 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 long time. The second the doctors came out, and it was specifically, in our case, something called the Ontario Medical Association, which is probably one of the most powerful medical bodies in the country, when they said it, it was on the front page of every newspaper in the country and the national news. It was like, oh my God, doctors are now saying it. It must be real. Like, it was mind-blowing to see how that changed almost overnight just by shifting who was talking about it and how they were talking about it. You know, I usually start out really pessimistic and then I start thinking about things and I get optimistic. There are two things happening, I would say. On the optimistic side, I'm amazed that we're seeing as much action, as I mentioned, from individual companies that are voluntarily taking this stuff out. I mean, voluntarily because, you know, social media and mothers groups and parents groups and nurses and activists are all pointing it out. But they're really worried about their brands, and they want to make sure that their brands aren't tarnished. So that's really why they're doing it. But they're still doing it, which is huge, and they're doing it significantly. In fact, Rick and I have just been helping out the it's a company in Canada that is not a household name, but it's the single largest brand manufacturer in Canada of everything, food, personal care products, huge, huge, huge company. And they, like, sitting down with them for days and days, they want to figure out how they can take all of this stuff out. Like, they are, it's like they're so genuine. Rick and I go, holy shit, like, this is unbelievable. And they're asking us all these questions, like, oh, like, I don't know, like, it's really, you know, I would always turn around to them and said, I don't know, like, it sounds like you're the experts. Like, it's like mind-blowing to see how genuine this massive company is. Where I'm pessimistic is with governments and this kind of relationship between some of the companies who may be doing the right thing over here for their brand image, but at the same time are sending in their lobbyists to actually make sure that we don't have regulations and make sure we slow things down. And so so governments are really trailing on these issues in particular. I would say the public is way ahead of government. Sophisticated companies are way ahead of government. And but it's that, in fact, we're doing a research project right now. There's some interesting stuff going on, well, in Canada and globally, where people are trying to expose the disconnect between companies' public statements and the lobbying that they're doing behind the scenes. And that is, to me, super interesting stuff. And there's a group here, the Center for Media Democracy, which, I mean, they do amazing stuff in exposing that ALEC, which is the big lobby group against legislation in the U.S. And it's bigger and more concentrated in the U.S. than anywhere. I mean, I was telling, sorry for one end, I was telling a story just to the my documentary filmmaker this morning about how when our first book came out, Slow Death by Rubber Duck, you know, Rick and I did tons of media, you know, all over Canada and all over Australia, and then we're all excited. The book came out in Canada. We had something set up with Time Magazine. We had something set up with the NBC Today Show. We had something set up with Oprah. You know, we had plane tickets. We spent hours and hours, you know, talking to the people in those media outlets. And then for all three of them, like just within days before we were about to do it, it's like we got a call. Oh, the producers suddenly decided that we're going to do a different story instead. Like, and then we started digging around, going, okay, so what's going on here? And so we called some of our colleagues, like, you know, Pete Myers, and said, you know, do you know what's going on? And no one had, you know, concrete evidence, but certainly the rumors were that, you know, the DuPonts and the Dows and the big personal care products were actually going to those media outlets and saying, okay, keep these guys off. Because it was just so weird that, like, literally they were buying our plane tickets and then telling us not to come. So that's the part that worries me, is the extent of that. So that's what needs to be exposed, I would say, going forward, more and more. Thankfully, we don't have the same degree of lobbying in Canada. I mean, we have lobbyists, but it is, in my experience, you know, having spent a lot of time in the U.S. with my colleagues, it really does feel like it's way harder to make progress here. So the lawn pesticide issue, well, started out, it was fought in court, and there were some early court cases that the whole issue was giving, was whether or not a municipality had the jurisdiction to make a decision like that. And so the big chemical companies actually took, like Dow, in fact, took the municipality to court and said, you have no right to ban lawn pesticides, that's provincial jurisdiction. And it actually went to the Supreme Court of Canada, and they won, and that basically opened the floodgates. So then you got municipalities all over the country doing it, and then once a bunch of municipalities in a province did it, then the province would step in and say, well, you know, half the population's got these pesticide bans, we might as well just cover the whole province. So it was actually really fun to watch, because the lobbyists just lost at every turn, and the companies lost, and the spraying companies were all fighting it, and Dow also took Quebec, I think, to challenge Quebec under NAFTA. Like, it's sort of endless, but at every stage in the game, you know, the good guys won, and so it was very encouraging. Certainly the economics have really trumped the ecological stuff, and it's also it's a very good example of people ignoring information in front of them, right? It's not as though people didn't understand that the aquifers in California were at 5% of their, you know, original state, you know, and declining. You know, it wasn't as though people didn't understand that the temperatures were increasing and that we were disrupting the land surface and creating more heat and, you know, less absorptive capacity. It's just a very good example of people ignoring all of the warning signs and just blindly moving forward. Whether it's being handled, I don't know specifically how it's being handled right now, but I would say if you look at a 10 or 20 year stretch, it certainly hasn't been handled very well. And even I was surprised, I was saying to people, just in Canada, we've had sort of the same thing with all, you know, tons of cold and snow and rain from, you know, all on the east side. And then, you know, Vancouver's been like California all winter, which has been totally weird. But there's still a lot of moisture up there. So I was surprised I wasn't hearing more about what was going on in California, you know, 4 or 5 or 6 months ago, because I was thinking, okay, like, California's going to be, doomed. And then, you know, about a month later, it started coming out. But so, I mean, I'm sure people were looking at it. But yeah, you know, I think on a macro scale, it has not been well handled. It's challenging. And if you look at the climate models going forward, this is the other thing that blows me away. Like, my very first thing I did when I graduated from university, a colleague of mine was working on this climate change study in 1992 in Ontario. It was called Degrees of Change, a Global Warming Strategy for Ontario. And basically every single thing we wrote about in 1992 and every single solution we wrote in 1992 has happened, well, except the solutions haven't happened. The solutions are still relevant, they just haven't happened. But everything has happened, except it's happened faster. So all those models that people poo-poo about global climate change, they're actually remarkably accurate. And if you look at the models for California, it's very scary. If you look at the models for southeastern Australia, Sydney to Melbourne, like, it's gonna be uninhabitable in 50 years. If you look at the models for Florida and the east coast of the US, so like this is where the cognitive dissonance thing is coming in. It's just like, whoa, like how can you not be looking, like 50 years isn't very far. That's just, you know, driving to LA and back a few times. It's not very far away. So I just, like, that's the part I don't get. Like, it's, like, we can see this, you know, and for me, it's in within my lifetime, you know, at least the last 50 years. Like, so, I'm genuinely mystified by this. You have to engage different generations differently, and that's certainly something that, you know, people are understanding more and more. A lot of people are trying to understand, you know, how to engage your generation, because it is a I have two daughters that one just graduated from university and one's in university. One of them's pretty easy to engage. The other one, like, woo, like, holy cow, like, you know, she's got like 19 devices going and, you know, out drinking all night. But anyway, you know, it's going to depend. But I would say there's a little bit of a myth around the idea. I think the older generation, you know, my generation, are either hopeful or guilty, embarrassed or delusional in thinking that, oh well, those young people, you know, they're just like so smart and so connected, and you know, they'll figure it out. But it's not like we haven't really done a very good job through the generations. Like I still, you know, I'm like kind of tail end post baby boom. So I blame the baby boomers. Like they're the ones that really screwed it up. I'm just kind of caught in the middle. But then of course every generation has that feeling. But it really will. Actually, I was describing this to someone the other day. When I had my first summer job, I was working for a mining company in northern Canada, and I was with three other geology students. That's my background, and the four of us, decided that if we found anything that looked promising as an ore body, that we weren't going to tell the mining company. And for me, looking back, that was a revolutionary concept. Like that was something. There was something in our generation where we were more concerned about the beautiful, pristine lakes that we were in, and the fish and the forests. It's going to take that. But I think it's happening. And another. I'm rambling around on this, but another line I'll just use, which is a great one, that a colleague of mine in Canada, who's actually running the federal Liberal campaign right now, uses, is that we're going to make progress one retirement at a time. And And there is some truth to that. You know, I've watched through my work on the electricity sector, you know, there are actually individual people in positions of power who block things for decades. And I'm already seeing now, which is why I'm optimistic around businesses and things, like people that are my age that grew up understanding ecology and know they need to do a better job, and they might be working for oil companies or chemical companies or manufacturing companies, but we all get together and have a beer and we talk about the same things and think the same things. So I think that's the piece. It's this, there is really a generational shifts that take place. And so I'm not so stressed out about people on their iPhones and other things, you know, being distracted, like, you know, hey, I do that too. So I think as long as you know that, you know, when you're doing your work or when you're leaving here at some point and you're making choices about what you buy or what you do or, you know, where you're going to travel, like you're thinking about it more than just, you know, a shallow personal reason, that you're thinking more broadly. So I'm optimistic.